Welcome, everybody. And now I'm just going to briefly introduce Burt Riggs. I'm going to read two sentences from his bio because it shows why he's the perfect person to take over from me here this morning. He recently retired as an archivist at Memorial University, but he's the editor of two books of World War I letters.
The theme for this event, Newfoundland and Labrador and World War I, 100 years later, legacies and learnings. On January 22, 1919, just 10 weeks after the end of the war, Dr. Levi Curtis, the superintendent of Methodist education for Newfoundland, seconded by Dr. Vincent Burke, the superintendent of Roman Catholic education for Newfoundland, presented a resolution at a meeting of the Newfoundland Patriotic Association. That resolution read, that this association agree to take into consideration the advisability of erecting a memorial to the 1,609 young men, soldiers, and sailors who had died in the Great World War, in the form of an educational building to the soldiers in the trenches. The religious beliefs of the men next to them mattered not, nor did it matter to the nurses in the casualty clearing stations, the VADs in the recuperation hospitals. And so, the new college came into existence, one in which there would be no separation of classrooms for Methodists, Anglicans, and Roman Catholics. Margot Iris Dooley, named for her famous aunt, daughter of a member of the Newfoundland Regiment who survived, niece of a member of the Newfoundland Regiment who was killed a week before the war ended, esteemed academic, graduate of Memorial University.
What I'm going to talk about are some neglected legacies of World War I. On this day, September 1st, 1915, exactly 100 years ago, the untested volunteer Newfoundland Regiment had just landed in Egypt. They were, in fact, just boarding a train to Cairo. Their ultimate destination is the Eastern Front in Turkey. Patriotic, young, and adventurous, they are so unaware of the true dangers they face. By war's end on November 11, 1918, only a fragment of the original regiment remained. 1,300 were dead, another some 2,300 had been wounded. There were, of course, additional losses among sailors and Newfoundlanders serving in other armed forces, including that of Canada. Newfoundland's small population was ill-equipped to absorb all of this. However, largely absent from Newfoundland's collective memory of the Great War are the enduring personal costs on the lives of men, women, and families of the Great War generation. This neglect stems from an asymmetrical, gendered history of warfare in general, certainly not unique to Newfoundland and Labrador. Wars are usually analyzed in terms of military strategy, battles, big power rivalries, political decisions, in short, the world of soldiers and men. Some things are missing. Women and their experience of war and the hidden costs of the aftermath that remained within families. The Great War was fought on an unprecedented scale. It was the first war of mass civilian mobilization. Women's support for the war effort in formal public organizations, in the workplace, and within the family economy, something that I think Barbara Doran has become very, very aware of, were critical components of the outcome. So, what exactly did women do? There were a very small number of female munitions workers in St. John's, very dangerous work. Female telegraphers kept the key transatlantic cable station at Heart's Content going. Young women volunteered as ambulance drivers, nurses and nurses' aides, or VADs, overseas. Despite military authorities' denials, some were very much in harm's way on hospital ships, at casualty clearing stations, and as ambulance drivers in France. Nurse Isabel Holden from St. John's cared for 33 wounded soldiers unaided when her hospital was bombed in Salonika. Mostly, however, and overwhelmingly, Newfoundland women were mobilized more traditionally under the banner of the Women's Patriotic Association. It was headquartered in Government House. The WPA spread to virtually every town or outport in Newfoundland of any size and also to Battle Harbor in Labrador. Despite its highly conventional name, and this is something I just want to stress, it in fact functioned as part of a dispersed military supply line for many items. Newfoundland women in the WPA knitted tens of thousands of socks to military specifications, essential to prevent trench feet. They sewed army shirts and undergarments. WPA members were also appalled when soldiers and sailors arrived home semi-invalids and lobbied for and helped to run a military hospital and a TB camp. When war ended, the leaders of the WPA, led by Armine Gosling, launched the Newfoundland women's suffrage movement. They demanded full citizenship in recognition of their war work and their personal sacrifices in losing so many of their menfolk. They also insisted upon a say as full citizens in shaping their small nation. Many hoped a woman's vote would become a peace vote. And it was a movement that was not simply restricted to St. John's, it really permeated all of the outports. WPA activists also wanted to improve their dominion and launched a host of groups that strengthened social safety nets, including the Child Welfare Association, the Newfoundland Outport Nursing and Industrial Association. They also lobbied and helped to fundraise for war memorials. And I might add that I see in this audience some descendants of this absolutely remarkable generation. In our collective memory of Newfoundland and Labradorian women in World War I, we usually remember the sock. It's a comforting, sentimental, and homely image. But the very choice of the word comforts to describe women's work in connection with that war is curiously partial. It did involve it, but it is partial. We've just barely begun to integrate a full picture of what that generation of women did during the Great War into our narratives and their reaction afterwards to the cataclysm.
Our second speaker this morning is Dr. Barbara Doran. Filmmaker extraordinaire, she knows more about sweatshops, women prisoners in Pakistan, AIDS workers in South Africa, killers on death row, and her most recent documentary, Newfoundland at Armageddon, a joint production directed by Brian McKenna, which will air on the CBC on the 100th anniversary of the first day of the Battle of the Somme on July 1st next year.
They're descendants of the soldiers, and they're reliving their ancestors' bloody battle.
Involving actual people in a story like this, people whose family went through it, brings it to a whole different level.
The second reason that we wanted to recruit young people is that we felt that maybe young people didn't know enough about the experience of war, or maybe didn't care, and that it was really important to expose at least a few of them through this direct experience. And when we talk about war, we seldom talk about women and the contribution that they made. And not only the contribution that they made, but the contribution they made after the war. Because when the men came back from the war, the ones who did survive were never the same. They often sat in silence, would not talk about the war, could not cope with the horror of it, perhaps didn't want to burden their families with it. In part of our recruitment, we did an open line show on CBC Radio, and caller after caller phoned to say that it was only after my grandfather died or my great uncle died did we know that he was actually a part of the war. It was just never, ever spoken of. I just want to say a few words about General Haig, who led the men on that July 1st morning in 1916. Haig was known as the Butcher of the Somme. The men were led into a battle that it was clear they could never win. Two regiments had been sent over that morning before the Newfoundlanders were sent. They had to climb over bodies to actually engage. Haig did not believe in machine gun warfare. He thought it was overrated. He sent those men out with rifles and bayonets, and he told them to march as if on a parade ground, not to charge. And the Germans saw them coming, and the Germans could not believe their eyes that after so many were killed, that a halt wasn't called to the Newfoundland Regiment going over the top. The loss from that war, in terms of the lives and the suffering, the loss, the war debt crippled us. Shortly after the war, the price of salt fish dropped on the world market. We had the expensive railway to pay for. All of those factors led into our bankruptcy, and our bankruptcy led to commission of government, and commission of government led to our loss of nationhood. So when we think about war, let's think about the cost of that as well.
Edward Roberts, member of the House of Assembly, cabinet minister, lieutenant governor, honorary colonel in chief of the Royal Newfoundland Regiment, editor of the memoirs of Captain Sidney Frost of the Royal Newfoundland Regiment.
I won't take issue with Barbara, except to say that her view of Haig is outdated, incorrect, wrong, and unsubstantiated. All you have to do is read some of the recent historiography, but all I'll say about Haig, and Barbara and I have had this discussion. The GWVA asked the same individual to preside at both events, Field Marshal Earl Haig. So the men who fought and the men who came home, whatever you may think of Haig, asked him to preside at the two most memorable events that they organized to commemorate the war. Anyway, we're here to talk about Beaumont Hamel. And the Battle of Beaumont Hamel was a small incident, not small to us, but a small incident on the first day of the Battle of the Somme. The Battle of the Somme went on for 5 months. The battle on the first day covered about 16 miles of the front line, the British front line, which was also, of course, matched by the German front line. 120,000 British soldiers, including the Newfoundlanders. We were the only Imperial unit there. There were a few Canadians came along later in July and August. Oh, and there were a handful from Bermuda in the Lincolnshire Regiment. 120,000 British soldiers fought that day. 57,000 of them became casualties. Churchill called it the single bloodiest day in the history of the British Army, and he was correct. 19,000, and I'm rounding numbers, 19,000 of those men were killed. The numbers, just to say the numbers, it's hard to believe. But 19,000 men, including, I think the figure we generally accept is 324 Newfoundlanders in our regiment, our battalion, were killed. In any event, they attacked. The first thing to remember is they weren't ordered to do what they'd been trained to do. They were trained to be the third wave of the attack in that sector. And remember, 150 battalions, 120,000 men at 800 a battalion were in the attack that morning in the two big waves. Our guard were to go to Station Road, the German third line, to clean up, to tidy up, to take prisoners. That was what their mission was. They were about 45 degrees to the left of where they were originally supposed to attack. Their orders were changed. They were sent down along the side of Y Ravine to attack the German front line. And of course, they never stood a chance. It's just simply not correct to say there were no British machine guns there. That's just one of the many myths or lies. But the German machine guns cut them down. I don't think anybody will ever know whether any of our men made the front line. But I'll tell you, if they did, it was only a handful. There's a great deal we don't know. The heroism, the gallantry, the courage, the devotion, that was all real. Nobody could have expected those men to do what they did, and not a man shirked. Every one of them went forward. Only a handful came back. Trying to figure out why the order was given. Why did they give the order? What led Frost to conclude it was the greatest blunder of the war? The white flare may be the answer. There was a white flare seen from the German lines, and that was the signal that the Frontstein troops, the two battalions that had gone before, the four, two in front of the Essex, two in front of the Newfoundlanders, were supposed to send up saying, "We're here." But it was also the German signal back to their artillery a couple of miles back saying, "More shells, more shells, more shells." There were no British troops in the German front line that morning who were alive. There may have been one or two who were dead or wounded on the wire. So that may be the answer. I don't know. But the other thing I'll leave you with, Umberto, are you looking meaningfully at your clock? It's in his official report to the governor, which was printed. It's in the official book after the war, the first 500, the official history. It shows up in the Cambridge history or the Times history, I forget which one, of the British Empire. It was the official line which was believed. That our guys were sent out somehow to help somebody else on the field, maybe the Irish who were a mile south at Teepvale. And our guys took the fire that otherwise would have gone to the Irish. I mean, you can make the arguments, but they're all in the fog of war. Anyway, I think I've said what I need to say, maybe too much. But let me tell you that Beaumont Hamel was a moment of which every Newfoundlander can be proud and should be proud, and which each of us should remember. But militarily, it really was, as Frost said, the most colossal blunder of the war. Thank you.
What we'd like you to think about and talk about at your various tables during the breakout session is the following question. What do you see as the greatest myth that has been created and perpetuated about the Newfoundland Regiment in World War I? What is the enduring legacy?
Here at the back of the room, we looked at the question of myth within the context of what's overlooked. We heard stories about people growing up in Newfoundland, yet really only hearing about Beaumont Hamel. It was 45 minutes of action in what was really a five-year war. So this opens up the question of what is overlooked. There are lots of success stories, battles won really against great odds. So why did the story of tragedy rise to the top?
I had the fortunate opportunity of being the only outsider at my table. Our talk was quite interesting, and I learned a lot. I think one of the most interesting points that was shared with me was how the war affected the overall psyche of Newfoundland. And this was kind of divided into three sections. So the pride that was felt when the Newfoundlanders joined the war and supported the British in their effort. And then the second component being the horror of the loss of Beaumont Hamel and the tragedy of losing so many people in that one battle. And then the third one was the fact that Newfoundland paid off their entire war debt, which they said was they were the only country to do that. So it was a sense of honor.
So we talked a little bit about whether war was the cause of Newfoundland's confederation within Canada. And based on the discussions, we realized that it was not just the war. There were other things happening around at the same time. So for example, the fishery wasn't doing so well. It was a town of only 250,000 people. So if the major economy is not doing well, that had an impact. We talked about the depression that was ongoing at the same time. A really interesting fact that came up was that Britain itself, later on in the years, was also not doing well as a government. So apparently there's this myth about they paid people here to vote in favor of of Confederation.
So we had a really animated discussion with two generations of historians at our table here. Donc, on a parlé des mythes. Pourquoi veut-on avoir des mythes? Pourquoi créer des mythes? Pourquoi perpétuer les mythes? Dans ce cas-ci, donc c'est quoi le mythe qu'on essaie ici d'avoir au Newfoundland, à Terre-Neuve et Labrador? Donc, c'est de la, pour avoir des pour les mythes, on veut définir une réalité, une identité collective. Et qu'est-ce que c'est ici? C'est ce qu'on essaie d'adresser. L'accent est mis ici vraiment sur la défaite, ce qui est assez surprenant étant donné la force du peuple de Terre-Neuve, ce qu'on peut voir aujourd'hui, l'identité qui est extrêmement forte, la langue et tout ça. Par exemple, j'ai appris quelque chose que Memorial University, Memorial College était un produit un peu de la Première Guerre mondiale et en fait, ce qu'on célébrait, c'était pas un memorial pour la guerre, mais c'était un mémorial pour les étudiants, en fait. Donc, c'était vraiment fascinant. That battle was the beginning of something for Newfoundland, and really Newfoundland took its place in Canada following that tragic event.
Alors, en premier, nous avons parlé que Beaumont-Hamel était, et la Première Guerre mondiale plus généralement, était probablement le premier élément qui était partagé par l'ensemble des communautés sur l'île. So it was the first thing that all communities could share because all communities contribute by sending young men to the war. So it was a key element for the identity of Newfoundland. But one aspect that we talked, that Beaumont-Hamel kind of eclipsed, we forget to talk about the other success of Newfoundlanders in the First World War, such as Monty Lepreux. I think there's a big discussion that we had that there's a lot of Newfoundlanders who went abroad in the U.S. and the rest of Canada, and that's why the myth of the loss of the best and brightest is partly true and false at the same time. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
Another interesting conversation that we had was around the passing of time and as how, as the history moves or time moves forward and things that were once living history become just history, and how do we continue to keep and make those stories relevant? And we saw maybe there's an opportunity to draw connections between the wars that are going on today and what is living history with those of the past and put those together.
Another aspect we learned about was the legacy of victory that actually came out of this. And Bob here had a wonderful story. You can look at the effects and the Caribou Trail throughout Europe, that the Newfoundland Regiment, although they made the supreme sacrifice, was the basis of what soldiers and the Canadians did and how to fight and win at Vimy Ridge, their effects of, you know, doing the proper trenches, not doing such blatant charges. It led to save the lives of, I'm assuming, hundreds, if not thousands. Then there's the legacy of breaking down barriers, and this was touched on before, Memorial University. Here you had an island that was deeply divided by religion, and as a testament to the sacrifice, the individuals and then the families of Newfoundland honored them by creating a secular university that is now attracting people from around the world.
We've seen from the panel itself that myths for some might be truths for others. We spoke about the loss of nationhood, and I think it would be untrue to focus on that as one particular crisis, but really it's one event in a chain of events, stemming from the war to the paying off of debts, but it also involved the coming together of Newfoundlanders in ways that hadn't happened before. So you see the Women's Patriotic Association coming together, and something that came out of that was the suffrage movement. So really, it was a part of the building of the new Newfoundland identity.
The two topics today that we mentioned, the first one was this idea of if this was a mistake or a blunder. And I think that the really important theme that came out from all of this was, is that even really the point? So we could argue if it was a mistake or a blunder, that kind of thing. But does that actually change the outcome, or is it even the right question? Also, someone brought up the point that there was the introduction after this of the dissenting voice. So to look at other alternatives such as peace, such as different ways instead of maybe being involved in an army, being involved in other ways to still be involved. Because the point that hasn't changed is we still fight for ideas. And so potentially we do so with a different lens today. But that is something that we can take from such a tragic moment.
Alors, nous avons eu l'honneur de discuter entre autres avec l'honorable John Crosby ici à notre table. Et le premier point qui a été soulevé, c'est justement cette question que les mythes sont pas pareils pour tout le monde parce que Monsieur Crosby était tout à fait en désaccord avec la réputation de Monsieur Haig, du général Haig. Il croit qu'il aurait dû être pendu et, entre autres, il a soutenu ça en soulignant qu'il n'a jamais visité ses soldats qui étaient blessés dans les hôpitaux et s'il a été honoré par la suite, c'était par stupidité, tout simplement. But around creating this notion of heroism of those men that were lost, their potential that was never known, it's a way for a population who is dealing with a very difficult time to rationalize that tragic page in history to be able to move forward.
We took a step back and asked, if that is the case, what would be the factors that would lead to the creation of a myth? Why, what would there be, or who would be interested in that? And one of the ideas that was put forward was that given the challenges that Newfoundland was facing in the 1920s, was that the stories of Beaumont Hamel originally out of the war helped bring unity as well as a positive perspective to a time that was just so difficult and was dealing with so many difficult challenges. The final point we touched on was discussing why is it that it remains something that people are so passionate about today? And why is it that it can be polarizing or that people care so much about it? And one of the ideas we discussed is that with the events of Beaumont Hamel, it's not simply a historical event isolated from Newfoundland or any other country, but rather that it's an integral part of identity.
The most fascinating part of our discussion at this table was around this idea of myths or mistakes and blunders. And we had at our table someone who is both a historian and a former member of the Canadian military who was saying that we are ignoring the impact of technology. The decisions that were made at the time were based on very little information. There was confusion, but the important legacy that has come out of that is a history or a legacy of signals for Newfoundland. There's a legacy here with the Royal Canadian Corps of Signals, which is the 728 in St. John's. We see it with Marconi, also out of Newfoundland. There is a really strong kind of legacy there in communications and signals technology. And finally, just a quick kind of closing point was that the optimism of war that was used as kind of a driver to take a lot of men to war is one that is still used to encourage men and women to join the military now. That optimism about being home by Christmas is one that was used for Afghanistan when we didn't know what time, you know, how long that war was going to take. But we can see that still happening today. So it was a fantastic discussion at our table. Thank you.